không à?
Now I will Montipun Setia, the editor of Gunitsara, to say presently Manjil Patim Sekia postdoc.
Thank you, Paroma. I'm very happy that this webinar is being held today. Let me say very briefly about Gunitsara. So we started Gunitsara 10 years back, nine years and 2 months back. So this is the 10th year of our running. And we are an online platform where we publish articles related to mathematics and science in English and Assamese. So we have two separate websites, and I encourage everyone to go to our website and look at the articles, and also suggest us how to make it better. So this webinar is the first in the series that we have, and I'm very glad that the college, Lokhimpur Girls College, along with IQAC of the college, has agreed to organize this webinar with us. And I thank the principal, Dr. Surojit Bhuya, for this opportunity. I also thank the IQAC cell of the college and the lecture coordinator, Dr. Paroma Dutta, for facilitating this lecture. But my sincere thanks and most heartfelt thanks goes to Professor Surojit Borkotoki, who agreed immediately to deliver a talk on game theory. Professor Borkotoki is well known across India as well as internationally for his work in cooperative game theory. As our principal, Dr. Bhuya, has already said, he has been a professor of Dibrugarh University for a few years now, and he did his PhD also from that university. In between, he has held several visiting positions, including at Louisiana State University, BIT China, as well as SUT Bratislava in Slovakia. And he also has a big grant with Indo-UK collaboration in Queen's University, Belfast, I think, which is about to finish or still ongoing. And I'm sure that all the participants who have kindly joined us today, we have already 197 in this meeting. I'm sure that all these participants will greatly benefit from hearing Professor Borkotoki speak. So over to Paroma.
Now I welcome Professor Surojit Borkotoki to deliver his. Thank you, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much. All the organizers, including Gunitsara and Lokhimpur Girls College. It's a good opportunity, great opportunity for me also to be a part of this novel endeavor. In fact, and thank you also for your nice words, Dr. Bhuya, the principal of the Lokhimpur Girls College, and Manjil. So when I was asked by Paroma and Manjil to say something or to talk something about game theory, I was little bit kind of what to say or what not to say, kind of confused in some sense. Then I was told that this is a kind of open kind of forum where a heterogeneous group of people will be attending. So I thought I should not go more into details or more into depth of the topics of game theory. So basically what I am going to talk over here, it will be completely a kind of introduction to game theory. As less as possible, mathematics also. Because Paroma told maybe 2-3 hours back that there are people from non-mathematical background also here. So I think I should restrict myself not to talk much of mathematics in this presentation. And I also have seen that many people who are familiar with this topic, and who know many things on game theory and who are audience in this particular webinar or talk. So I, at the end of the presentation, I would request all of you to give your insights, to give your inputs to those who have attended this type of a seminar or this type of a talk for the first time. So with these words, let me share with you my screen. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Ah, thank you. So what I thought of as a title of my talk to be like game theory, can there be a theory to play a game? So the basic idea when I was designing my talk, the basic idea was like everybody is familiar with the word game. Then there is a, you know, there is a word coined with game, game theory. So that means there must be some theory in it. And the immediate question comes to a layman's mind that can there be a theory to play a game? So when we play a game, should we think of some theory behind that game? So when it comes to, it occurs to us, when it comes to game theory, it occurs to us that some fun field, you know, experiences, some fun field activities when we talk about a game. But in reality, or in maybe you can say in theory, game theory is something more than what we perceive about game. So that's why I will talk about different situations, different examples where we can put it some mathematical models, we can make some mathematical models out of it. But I don't want to, you know, as I have already told you, I don't want to give detailed mathematical models of this situations, but I will try to infuse the idea how these games can be, or how a social situation can be considered to be a game, and how a theory can be developed to explain the game, to predict the game, to predict the outcomes of the game. These are the certain aspects I am going to cover. I try to cover. Okay. So let me start with an example, or maybe a story, I would say. So you must be familiar with this story. Let me tell you again, once more. It was about Akbar and Birbal. So when one day, you know, Akbar was a great Mughal emperor and Birbal was his smartest minister. When one day Akbar wanted Birbal, and he called Birbal and he said that I want to take bath with milk the very next morning, and I want my ministers to bring a bucket of milk to fill up my bathtub. Then Birbal said that your desire will not be satisfied, your highness, your desire will not be satisfied. Akbar was very angry. He said that how can this be possible? I am the emperor and I am asking my ministers to bring milk and a bucket of milk and to fill up my bathtub. And why my desire will not be satisfied? Then Birbal told Akbar that, okay, wait and see. And you ask your ministers first to bring bucket of milk to pour into your bathtub and wait and see. Then of course, the emperor Akbar asks his ministers, all the 100 ministers, to bring bucket of milk and to pour it on his bathtub. But a problem lies there, because all the ministers were smart enough. What did they do? They thought that every other minister would be bringing milk, so it is it is for each of them will be less productive or less profitable if they bring milk rather than bringing water. So that means it's something like that. Suppose I am one of the ministers. I would think that if everybody is bringing milk, if I bring water, then what would happen? There will be no difference in the bathtub. One bucket of water will mix up with all the 99 buckets of milk, and still the bathtub will be filled with milk. But the problem is, all the ministers thought the same way. And it was very much rational for all the ministers to think that way. And everybody, it turned out that everybody brought water the next morning to the bathtub, and the bathtub was filled with water instead of milk. So this particular story portrays a very interesting phenomenon in game theory. It is called tragedy of commons. I will be coming to this part, but let me conclude with a note here that the best way for everyone was to bring water instead of milk. And that's why, and Birbal knew it in advance, and that's why Birbal told Akbar that your desire will not be fulfilled. Okay. So next, I will come to another story. It's about a TV serial. It was named a Survivor Thailand. So there was it's a reality kind of show where this game was played between two players. There are 21 flags, as you can see on this on the right of your screen. There are 21 flags and there are two players. And each player, suppose player one is removing one flag or two flags or three flags. At the most, he can remove three flags at his turn or each turn. And the second player will also remove one, two, or three flags when his turn comes. So in this way, say if I am the first player, I am removing, for example, three flags, then you are the second player, you are also removing three flags, so there will be six flags removed, then there will be how much? Whatever flags remain, then I will again, in the next step, I will again remove one or two or three flags from that, and the process continues this way. And finally, the winner will be that person who removes the last flag. Maybe it can be one flag, it can be two flags, or it can be three flags. So this is the game. And if you look at this game, there is a very interesting theory about it. So if two players, without knowing anything, without any strategy, without any theory, if two players are playing this game, so one player would, you know, remove one flag or two flags or three flags, the other player will also remove accordingly the flags, and finally they would not know exactly who will be the winner. But if you have a particular strategy of removing the flags, you are going to win the game always. So what is that strategy? Let me just give you a brief idea about it. So here the number 4 is very important in this case. So if you look at the structure 21, so suppose I want to be the winner and you are my opponent, I want you to have 4 flags in your hand before the last stage, so that out of these 4 flags, if you remove 1, 2, or 3 flags, there will still be 1, 2, or 3 flags for me to remove, and I will be the winner. So therefore, for me to be the winner, I should make arrangement in such a way that you should be left with only four flanks in the last but one stage. And for that, the previous step to the last but one, if I want you to have four flags in the previous stage, I want you to have eight flags. And similarly, the previous step, you must have 12 flags and so on. So this is a sequence of flags. Say it starts with 21. So if I am the first person and I want to be the winner, I will remove a single flag first time and I'll leave 20 flags for you to remove. And then whatever you remove, I will try to make you leave with 16 flags, then 12 flags, then 8 flags, and finally 4 flags. Then I will be the winner. So there is a theory behind this game also. And if you know this theory in advance, before playing the game, suppose you are one of the players in the Survivor Island, Survivor Thailand, then you'd have won the $30 million prize over there. So there is always a theory behind this game, all these games. Let us come to a next, sorry. Yeah, I am taking another example for you. So I don't know why this particular game is called the beauty contest game. It is a generalized beauty contest game. It was actually initiated by, or in a more mathematically formulated by Harvey Mullen. So here the contest is about, say, suppose there are 10 students in a class and you are giving 10 blank cards to all the students and you allow them to write their names on one side and the other side, they can write some number between 0 and 100. And what is the rule of the game? Suppose everybody writes some number between 0 and 100 and then you collect these numbers and suppose there are 10 students, of course. So you collect these numbers and you take the average. Now, the student whose number is close to the half of the average, suppose the average is 50, for example. So half of the average is 25. The student who chose a number which is close to 25, the closest to 25, will be the winner. So this is again a very interesting game. You can see if everybody knows about it, suppose in the first play, you pick up 10 students from your class and you allow them to, you know, choose numbers between 0 and 100. In the first play, they will not understand exactly what to do. But if you go on allowing the same set of players to play this game repeatedly, then they will realize that above 50, if they would, you know, take some numbers, it will be not useful for them because the average is always 50 because the maximum number they can take is 100. So average is around 50. But again, they would see if average is around 50, then half of this average is 25. That means that student who is taking something very close to 25 will be the winner. But if they know that in advance, then they will not go beyond 25. Everybody will stick to some number near to 25. But then what happens? The average will be 12.5. And then if the average is 12.5, everybody would try to take some number which is close to 12.5. Maybe 10, for example. Suppose close to 10. But then what happens? If everybody is taking 10, close to 10, the average will be around, half of the average will be around 5. And then finally it turns out to be everybody's benefit would be in taking 0. Because if everybody takes 0, the average will be 0. Half of the average is also 0. So everybody is going to be a winner. So this is a very interesting game, which is called the generalized beauty contest. And again, there is a theory behind this game. So let me give you a very informal way of defining game. So a game is a situation with multiple decision makers. We call them players. Each player endowed with a set of actions, strategies we call. When each player adopts a strategy, there will be an outcome, and we call it a payoff. Okay. So should I pause for a second? Should I take some questions in between? Is there any questions?
Sir, till now there is no any queries coming.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. So I have given you some fun games, some examples of fun games. Let me take some examples from the society. The very interesting example from the society can be taken from this. This is called a battle of sexes. Somebody would say this is a coordination game. So in this game, what happens? A couple deciding to spend the evening together. So there is a husband, there is a wife, and they want to spend the evening together. But the problem is with the, you know, kind of choice or the preference of the husband and the wife. The wife prefers a movie. The husband wants to go to a cricket match. Because the wife's preference is a movie and the husband's preference is a cricket match, there is a situation of coordination failure. But they have their own preference that they want to spend their time together in the weekend. So who will go where? Will the husband join the wife to a movie, or the wife joins with the husband to a cricket match? So there is a problem. So this is a game theory. This is a game problem. This is a very interesting problem. It's a game. It's called a game. This game is called coordination game. Now you can see on the bottom side of the slide. We can consider this to be a kind of a matrix. Everybody is familiar with the term matrix. So you can consider, say, player one to be the wife. There is no problem if player two is the husband. And then player one has these two options, movie and cricket. And also player two, that means the husband also has these two options, movie and cricket. Then here you can see player one, when he or wife chooses movie, her payoff is two. That means this payoff can be considered to be a satisfaction. So she is more satisfied with a movie, so she gets payoff two. Whereas husband, when he goes to movie along with the wife, his some amount of, you know, satisfaction will be there because he spends his time with his wife. And for that, he is getting some payoff one. But if wife goes to movie, chooses for movie, and husband chooses for cricket, there will be no payoff for either of them. And similarly, for cricket and movie, there will be no payoff for either of them. But again, if the wife prefers to go or chooses to finally, you know, decides to go to the cricket match with the husband, the wife will be less satisfied with payoff, say, something one. This one, two, these are some numbers to, you know, to let you know exactly some kind of ordering. This two is greater than one, one is less than two. That means the satisfaction is less here, satisfaction is greater there, something like that. So here in the last case, when cricket is the strategy for wife and husband, then the satisfaction for wife will be one and the satisfaction for husband will be two. Now, again, the question, if this is the situation, so the initially this was the social problem. Now we have made a mathematical formulation of this problem. And now the question is whether the wife joins with the husband or the husband joins with the wife. And this problem is called called the battle of sexes, and also it is a general type, it's a particular type of the general coordination game. And I will come to a solution of this particular game later on when I talk about the solution concepts. Okay, so there is a very interesting variation of this battle of sexes, this coordination game. This is called a corruption game. And this corruption is everywhere prevalent in our society. So the game theorists are also modeling corruption using mathematical formulations. So what is the idea? The idea is like a businessman wants a permit from the government official for doing some business. The businessman has two strategies. Either he is to be honest, he does not bribe the official, or he will go for a shortcut method and he will bribe the government official. And also the government official also has two strategies. Either he remains honest or he takes the bribes from the businessman. So if this is the situation, then we can again, what is the problem? We can identify the problem. What should they do? Whether the businessman would bribe the government official, or he remains to be honest, or the government official also takes the bribe from the businessman, or he remains to be honest. And then this can be again kind of modeled with some mathematical formulation by this table, or you can say this matrix. Here the businessman also has two strategies, being honest or being corrupt. Government officer is also having two strategies, honest or being corrupt. And when the businessman is honest and the government officer is honest, their payoffs will be 3 and 1. And if businessman is honest and the government officer is corrupt, then the businessman would maybe inform to the concerned authorities about the government officer's intention, and the government officer will end up being put into the jail. So this can be -2. -2 is something which is a punishment. If it is a positive quantity, it's something like a profit. If it is negative, we consider this to be a cost. So similarly, this is another example of this coordination problem, and this coordination problem is also having both possibilities there, whether both of them should be honest or both of them to be corrupt. Like both of them, like in the battle of sexes, both of them would be choosing for the movie or choosing for the cricket match. Okay. So COVID-19 has given us a lot of, newer dimensions of talking about newer situations, on talking about newer mathematical models, newer problems. And here is a very simple problem that arose from this COVID-19 pandemic situation. And that's why there are also positives of negatives. This is my take about COVID-19. So what it says, so suppose there is a game called wearing mask game. What is it? So there are two players, as you know, wearing a mask. Suppose I am wearing a mask. I am not helping myself mostly, but I am helping my neighbor. Because if I wear a mask, I will not spread the virus to my neighbors. Similarly, if the neighbor is not wearing a mask, that means my neighbor will spread the virus to me. And if he or she is wearing a mask, that means he is not going to spread the virus to me. That means I will be affected if my neighbor wears a mask or if my neighbor does not wear a mask. Similarly, my neighbor will be affected if I wear a mask or I don't want to wear a mask. So that's what this rule of the game says. Suppose if X wears a mask, Y is safe. And if Y wears a mask, X is safe. So from game theoretic perspective, what should we do? Should we wear a mask for our own benefit? Should you wear a mask for your own benefit or for the other's benefit? So there it is, another very interesting example. And I will talk about this again when we talk about and when we go to the solution concepts. Let me give you a very brief discourse of this prisoner's dilemma. This prisoner's dilemma is a very interesting problem in game theory. Lot of applications of prisoner's dilemma are there. So I'll try to briefly tell you exactly what it means. So the idea is, suppose two convicts are put into two cells, separate cells. They don't have any coordination, they don't have any communication between them. And the police, the investigating team, would try to find out whether they are guilty or not. So these two convicts, they have two options, they have two strategies. One is whether they will kind of confess or they will not confess. The rule of the game is that if both of them will confess, you can see in the last in the bottom part of the slide, if both player A and B, these are the two prisoners, I can say that they are players. If A and B, they both confess, they will get 3 years of jail term. But if A confesses and B does not confess, suppose A and B, there is a communication before they were put into jails, there was a communication between A and B, and there was an agreement. Yeah, there was some disturbances and I had to stop. Anyway, so suppose A and B were to make some agreements between them. And suppose they would say that, okay, whatever punishment we are being given, we don't confess, because if we don't confess, we'll get just 1 year of jail terms. Otherwise, if we confess, we'll get 3 years of jail term, both of us. But the problem is, the rule of the game is something like, if one confesses and the other does not confess, the one who is confessing, he becomes the government witness and he will be freed. He does not have to go to the jail. But if the other one, because he is not confessing, this one is confessing, the other one will get 9 years of jail. What happened?
Sorry, there was an issue. I had to cancel the. Yes, please.
Okay. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay. So finally, you can see from this matrix, because if all these numbers will be the jail terms in terms of years. So if both of them confess, then there will be 3 years of jail. One confesses, the other does not confess, then there will be 9 years of jail for the not confessing person and no jail for the confessing person, or something like that. And then what would they do? This is the dilemma. What will be their kind of action? What strategy they will take? Whether they both will confess, whether they will not confess, or whether one of them will confess and the other one will not confess. So this is a very interesting dilemma. Again, I will be coming to this dilemma. What will be the solution? I will come to that later on. So there are different examples of this prisoner's dilemma. One was the advertisement game long back in 1970s in the US. So this game was between two cigarette companies. One is RJ Reynolds and the other one is Philip Morris. In 1970, the government of US government, federal government of the US, they decided, they asked these two companies not to advertise, and they gave some kind of immunity to these two cigarette companies from any kind of justice, any kind of trials. In return, they stopped doing advertisements of their cigarettes. So before 1970s, what they did, they advertised a lot on their about their products. So if there was no advertisement, then both of them will share the market in some sense, and they will be happy because there will be cost of advertisement is less, and obviously only the products or the productions will be the profits will matter. But what happens if one company knows that the other, or one company, suppose there is an agreement between these two companies that we are not going to spend any money on the products or the advertisement. But after this agreement, suppose one company breaks this agreement and he and it starts advertising its products. Then what happens, because of this advertisement, there will be more sale, there will be more market share of that particular company, and this company will gain out of it. Whereas the other company who believed about the, you know, agreement of the other with the other company, that company will be at loss. So definitely, what is the best possible way? Finally, it turns out to be both of them should go for advertisement. If even if this cost of advertisement makes their profit little less than if there were no advertisement. So this is a very interesting example of prisoner's dilemma. So there are different, you know, examples. There are examples of, say, pollution. So there are two countries whether they will, you know, reduce the carbon emission or they will go for industrialization, more productive productions through industrial activities. So these are different strategies, and these are explained by the, you know, this beautiful phenomenon of prisoner's dilemma. Then let me revert back to this game in the story of Akbar and Birbal. And in fact, this game I was talking about in the very beginning of my talk, this game is a clear example of this prisoner's dilemma. In fact, this is, as I told you, the tragedy of commons, and this tragedy of commons is a clear example of prisoner's dilemma. What it says, suppose instead of 100 ministers, suppose we are taking two ministers at a time, and they have two strategies. Either both of them will bring milk or they will bring water. So of course, bringing milk is somehow, you know, costly. Then water. So suppose payoff for bringing milk when both bring milk. Suppose both the ministers will suppose may bring milk, then what would be the payoff? Say it is S, for example. Then suppose the other minister is bringing water and I am bringing milk, then what would be my payoff? Because I become the victim, so I take it V. Then similarly, when I am bringing water and considering that the other one bringing milk, then I become the race and my...
Sorry, sir, there is some sort of issue.
Okay, from in my end or somewhere else?
No, some other issue. Sorry, please continue.
Okay. It's okay, no problem. These are technical things. We have to bear with it. Anyway. And finally, suppose both the ministers would bring water, then there will be some payoff. That would be the common strategy payoff, T. That's right. And you can see, because if I am bringing water and you are bringing milk, I will be the high, kind of my profit will be the maximum. So R is greater than every other payoff. R is greater than S. S is what? Everybody, both of them will be bringing milk. And T is the tragedy of commons payoff. So if both of us will be, you know, bringing water, then this will be given by the payoff T. And finally, you are bringing water and I am bringing milk. That means I become the victim. And so my payoff will be the least. So T is less than V. And then the matrix of these two players, this particular game will be like this. And you can see bring water and bring water is the best possible way for both the ministers. And that's why these two ministers were so smart and Birbal anticipated that also. And they both brought water to the bathtub. So, how much time do I have, Manjil?
Sir, you can continue for 15 minutes.
Okay. So, So, let me give you a more
question. Actually, if you can answer that.
Okay. Is there any questions?
Yeah. You're asking about Nash equilibrium.
Somebody is asking Nash equilibrium.
Yes.
Okay, because I have kept it for my follow-up slides. I will come to that. Please bear with me. I will come to that. Okay. So what is a game? A game is a strategic kind of situations that is the behavior given by intelligent and rational agents who understand that their actions affect the actions of the other agents. So if I take a decision of my own, if there is no other in front of me, I can take my decision. There is no conflict with anybody else. But if I have to take a decision in front of or maybe in presence of some other people, then I have to take care of his or her decisions also. I have to take care of his or her strategies also. And there comes the concept of games in game theory. Okay. So a game, I am giving some mathematical formulations, but I don't think this is very much important for us. I will come to directly the solution. So what is a solution in such a game? Suppose, like, as I have already explained to you, that what is a game? A game is a situation where there will be more than one people will be having his or her own strategies, try to maximize his own utility based on his strategies. And there will be kind of what will be a solution? Solution will be out of these different options, everybody is choosing one particular strategy, and this strategy finally, the set of strategies finally give you a particular solution. Now, whether this solution is feasible or not, or credible or not, that is the most important thing. Now there is the concept of equilibrium coming here. What is an equilibrium? Equilibrium is such a concept where everybody is in a very, simple way. What we can say about equilibrium is that everybody is happy with whatever strategy he or she is adopting, because everybody is getting something which, if he deviates or she deviates from his own strategies, he or she will not get from this particular game. So therefore, I think I should again. Yeah. So there is a very interesting concept called Nash equilibrium. It is after the name by John Nash. John Nash proposed this particular concept, equilibrium concept. And later on, because it was so popular, it was so kind of prominent and very significant in some sense, that this Nash equilibrium is itself a particular kind of tag. So this Nash equilibrium is, it's saying that suppose everybody else's strategies are fixed, if I want to change my own strategy, do I get any benefit or not? If I do not get any benefit from changing my own strategy, if I keep the other strategy fixed, I don't deviate from my own strategy, And that becomes the mass equilibrium for every player. And this has to be true for every player. Okay? So if you are not, if you are finding it difficult to follow this concept, let me go to this example. You can see the prisoner's dilemma, where you have these payoffs, confess and confess. When both the players are confessing, then they are getting 3 and 3. Both of them get a 3 year jail term. If one confesses and the other not confesses, then one gets, who is confessing, getting no jail, but the other one is getting 9 years of jail. Similarly, the other case, both of them do not confess, then there will be 1 year of jail. So obviously, those who do not know mass equilibrium, for them, this not confess and not confess will be the best possible strategy. And without knowing game theory, it is actually true. Because if you cooperate, if both the prisoners in advance, they try to, you know, make a binding agreement between them that we are not going to confess, then not confess and not confess will be the best possible way for both the players. But the problem here is, suppose prisoner A, thinking that prisoner B will also not confess, prisoner A does not confess, for example. And prisoner B is not so, you know, faithful, suppose, for example. You do not know, because prisoner B will be trying to maximize his own utility. So if he is not faithful into this agreement, then he would definitely confess, because he knows that A does not confess. Then it would be better for B to confess, not to not confess. Why? Because if B confesses, then he will be getting 0 term, but A will get 9 years. He does not care about A. Whether he gets 9 years of jail term or 3 years of jail term, B does not care about that. B cares only about his own jail terms. So if that type of selfish motive is there for both the players, A and B, and similarly, A also thinks the same way. The way B thinks, A also thinks the same way. And so A also, for A also, the best possible way is not to not confess, but to confess. So if both of them confesses, then they will get 3 years of jail term. If that is the situation, this is called a Nash equilibrium. So Nash proposed that for both the players, the dominant strategy for both of them is to confess, is not confess. So this is a very interesting solution concept. And this prisoner's dilemma is being kind of solved by this this proposal of Nash. So there is a example of this battle of sexes. Sorry. So you can see, if both of them go to movie, the wife will get more satisfaction than the husband, and the husband gets more satisfaction if both of them would go for cricket. If you look at it, if player one, that means the wife, keeping the husband to be in the movie, if the player goes, wife goes to cricket, so then her payoff will be less, from 2 to 0. Similarly, if player two, that means the husband, keeping the wife to be in the movie, and if he goes to the cricket, then his payoff will be less, one, from 1 to 0. So that means 2-1 is a Nash equilibrium. And similarly, you can see 1-2 is a Nash equilibrium. But that means either there are two Nash equilibriums here. That means either both the players, that means the husband and wife, both of them will go to the movie, or both of them will go to cricket. But still the problem is unsolved. Where should they go together? Whether it is a movie or it's a cricket match. So for that, we should know something more about it. Okay, similar is the case for the, I don't go into details of this. Here, it's a very interesting example. In the wearing mask game, what happens? You can see wearing mask and wearing mask gives you payoff 10 and 10. That means you are also benefited. The other person is also benefited. So 10 and 10 are the payoffs. But if X is wearing mask and Y refuses to wear mask, X wears, so Y will be safe, but X will be unsafe. So the payoff will be 0-10. Similarly, refuses to wear and wears a mask. This is 10-0 and both of them refuse to wear a mask. So their payoff will be 0. So here you can see all these three, 10-10, 0-10, and 10-0, all of them are Nash equilibriums. And interestingly, that means this is indecidable, or you can say it is indecisive whether you should wear a mask or not. But if you look at the problem, it is the best possible way if both the players are kind of considerate about the social social situations, then it is the best among the Nash equilibriums. The most credible Nash equilibrium is the wearing a mask and wearing a mask. And so using Nash equilibrium, we can say that wearing a mask is the best possible way for all of us to save ourselves or and also save the other people in our vicinity. And finally, the Akbar Birbal game, as I have already told you, I don't want to I will just touch one or more examples because time is not sufficient for me to take up all the different problems, because it's a big course in fact on game theory. Every example can give you different aspects, and you can talk about hours and hours on these ideas, and you can give different examples. You can create new examples also. Now suppose there is another way of representing a game that is called the extensive game. Suppose you see the penalty kick example. This player, jersey number 11, he kicks a ball on the left side of the goalpost, and the goalkeeper dives on the right. He could have dived on the left also, and this player could have, kicked on the right side of the goalpost also. So definitely, if you look at the attest diagram, here you can see the player can have two choices. Either he kicks on left or he kicks right. And the goalkeeper, if he kicks left, the goalkeeper can dive on the left or he can dive on the right. Similarly, the goalkeeper, if he kicks right, the goalkeeper dives on left or dives on right. And finally, if everything is very perfect, if the goalkeeper misses it, there will be a goal. If the goalkeeper catches it, there will not be a goal. So here, in the earlier examples, you know everything. All the information is there with you. But here, some information, that means the goalkeeper does not know where the player kicks, on the right or left. So his information is little bit gray about it. And that's why this type of games are called games with imperfect information. So let me come to the example of that flags, 21 flags I talked about in the very first couple of slides. Say, I told you that 21 flags, when it is 21 flags, and if I want to win the game, player, I should make it sure that player two must have in the end four flags so that I will win. So suppose there are five flags, and then these five flags, this game can be expressed in an extensive form game, whatever I have discussed just now. So here, suppose you can see there are 5 flags instead of 21 flags, and player 1, he removes 2 flags from 5 flags, so there will be 3 flags on the left. Either, or he can remove 1 flag from the 5 flags, there will be 4 flags here. Or he can remove 3 flags from 5 flags, so there will be 2 flags here. So if there will be 3 flags, player 2 will remove immediately these 3 flags and he will be the winner. Similarly, if there are 2 flags, because if a player can remove 1 or 2 or 3 flags at a time. So if player 2 has 2 flags with it, then he can remove these 2 flags at once and he will be the winner. The only possibility that 1 is a winner when 2 is left with 4 flags. And then when 2 has 4 flags, either he can remove 1 flag or 2 flags or 3 flags. But in either case, 1 has 3 flags, 2 flags or 1 flag. That means 1 will at once remove these 3 flags, 2 flags or 1 flags. So definitely this gives you an idea how that very game can be played. If it were a game theorist, he would be playing the game in this way. So there is a kind of, you know, the chess, game of chess can be also represented by this type of game tree. This is called a game tree, but don't try it manually because it has millions of kind of branches in this particular tree if you talk about a game tree for the game of chess. Okay, so the last part I'm going to talk about is, so I have talked about the strategic form of a game where we make some biometrics of payoffs, and I try to find out what is Nash equilibrium of that. Then I have just touched upon the extensive form game. I am giving you 2 examples so far. And these examples, now the solutions are like, they are called subgame perfect equilibrium for these solutions. And these subgame perfect equilibrium are nothing but Nash equilibrium again for a particular subgame with a game tree. So the third kind of game, in a broader way, the third kind of game is cooperative. So far, everybody is a competitive player. They don't have any communication. They don't have any binding agreements among the players. But now there is a type of game where the players agreements among themselves. And then this based on these binding agreements, they collectively build up something which they were not possible, they were not able to produce of their own individually. So here comes the concept of cooperation, and this type of game is called cooperative game. And here coalitions, a group of players will form, and then these coalitions will generate some value, and these values are being assessed. Okay, these values are being assessed. And finally, whatever value is being generated, that value has to be divided among the players in a rational way. So there is a very interesting story about this. Suppose there are 2 players, say 2 children, say 2 kids. They are to share a pizza, for example. So what is the best possible way to allow these kids to share their pizza? If suppose the kids are kind of childish like me, whoever gets the chance to divide the pizza, he is taking more for himself and a very small amount for the other kid. In fact, this small amount will be as small as possible, because the other kid who is given the chance to divide the pizza, he can take as much as he can take. There is no restriction. Okay, so what is the best possible way to divide the pizza between these 2 kids? and allow them to divide themselves about this. The best possible way is that one kid is allowed to divide the pizza and the other kid is allowed to take the first piece. So if you have, suppose I cut the pizza into two asymmetric way, and my opponent, the other kid, will take the is allowed to take the piece, then obviously he will choose the bigger one and I will be at loss. So basically, when such a thing happens, I am bound to cut the pizza into two equal halves because I don't want my opponent to get maximum out of it. So there is a, this is a very interesting example. But the problem arises when this same pizza can be divided among three people, or the same pizza can be divided into, say, 10 people. How will you divide? What will be the best possible way? So there is a branch of game theory where this type of studies are being also done. So I think I am almost done. I'll take probably your questions also. Let me just touch upon some of the brief history of this game theory. So in the 500 AD, there was the Babylonian Talmud, where there are some problems which are very much similar to the problems we are taking in game theory nowadays. Some problems, say there is a problem called where you have a man has, say, three wives. He is in the deathbed. He said that the three first wife will get this much, the second wife will get this much of his assets, and the third wife will get this much of his assets. But then finally it turned out that he didn't have that much of asset. Then whatever asset he had, how to distribute these assets among these wives the way he wanted to distribute. So this problem was initially, found in this Babylonian Talmud, but later on there was a lot of, theory developed over this particular problem, and it's a new branch in cooperative game theory where these type of problems are being dealt. Then there was two-person game and minimax principle in 1730. Then Cournot's duopoly in economics, that was has the flavor of game theory. Then in Darwin's survival of the fittest theory, the buds of evolutionary biology, evolutionary game theory developed later, much later, but it has got its roots over there. Then there are mathematical physics, concepts of mathematical physics, where some kind of game theory was there in 1881. In 1913, Zermelo, he is a great mathematician, he found that in a chess, either there is a chance of, playing draw, or there is at least one of them, either the white or the black, will win. So if you look at it, there is no such kind of nothing significant about this result. But this is a very big result in terms of, existence. That means there exists a solution. So that's why this result by Zermelo is very interesting and important. Then Borel, Emil Borel, also had some strategic games. And then so the formal game theory started with the book by Norman and Morgenstern, that was Game Theory and Economic Behavior. Then Problems of Monopoly and Economic Warfare, Nash Bargaining came up. Then Prisoner's Dilemma was actually proposed by different people, but it was formally presented before a group of psychology students by Adam Tucker, who was the supervisor of John Nash. Then there was this John Nash, who had a number of papers between 1950 and 1953. And these were kind of seminal publications, seminal work by John Nash. And then there was Shapley, Core, these were in cooperative games. Then in 1954-53, there were differential games. Then there are a lot of developments taking up in different areas. And now what happened? It's about network games.
Is it okay? Or is there any problem?
No. It says that I am muted. Is it?
No. You are not muted.
Okay. So I was a little bit confused. Anyway, I am almost done. In the last decade, we have new areas in game theory where we have networks. Then in computer sciences, in biological sciences, in political sciences, in economics, of course, applied mathematics, physics, where not? So wherever there is conflict of interest among the agents, you can think of game theory to explain the kind of these conflicts or predict the equilibrium concepts in it. So I think I should stop. I can Sir. Take, thank you very much. I can take your questions or maybe suggestions, inputs, whatever.
Sir, some few questions are coming up.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. One question is that, so if we know for a particular game, the perfect strategy exists, then can we determine the strategy of strategy mathematically?
No. No, perfect strategy means we know the perfect strategy. If we know the perfect strategy, immediately we have to take up the payoffs. What are the payoffs? So there are two things, game with perfect information and game with complete information. So game with perfect information or imperfect information, that means you don't know exactly what the other player is playing. You do not know in advance. That is imperfect information. But you know, wherever, whatever strategy is being played by the other player, you know exactly what will be the payoff coming out of that. Whether it's a goal or it is not a goal, you know in advance. There are two options, But there are situations where you don't have the payoffs or you do not know the preference of the players. And then it becomes incomplete information. So whatever this question asks, what I understand, if the strategies are perfectly known, so definitely there will be either payoffs are also known. If payoffs are also known, then we can make a biometrics out of it. If payoffs are not known, then we have to go for different types of the other player. Okay, and accordingly, the payoffs will be formed in different biometrics. So this is somehow little bit complex type of problems. Yeah.
Yeah. So there is one more question.
Yeah.
So is there any, give an example where Nash equilibrium do not happen?
Oh, there are a lot of examples. You can play with these games. I have given you so many examples. You can play with these games and you can find out a lot of such games where Nash equilibrium does not exist in pure strategies. Let me tell you pure strategies. Actually, I skipped one part of my talk where actually I was supposed to tell about mixed strategies. Like the Nash theorem is any non-cooperative game has a mass equilibrium in mixed strategy. What is mixed strategy? So every strategy is played with some probabilities. Okay, so that means the players are mixing their strategies with some probabilities. And then you talk about the expected values, and these expected values will give you some Nash equilibrium for sure. So that's why Nash theorem and Nash equilibrium is very important and very significant, because you have a non-cooperative game, whatever non-cooperative game, you can always find out at least one equilibrium, which is in mixed strategy equilibrium. Okay? But in case of pure strategy equilibrium, there are a lot of games where you don't have pure strategy mass equilibrium. Pure means you know in advance what you are going to play. Nobody is going to play the game because you know the payoffs accordingly. So accordingly, you just play the game. Yeah.
Okay. So I think this is a research type of question. So is there any connection between game theory and number theory? So in like research areas?
Actually, number theory is a purely mathematical kind of thing. And game theory is, of course, applied application mathematics, applied mathematics. So you are trying to, you know, model the social situations with some mathematical formulations. So definitely there will be combinatorics, there will be number theory, there will be a lot of other areas. In fact, every branch of mathematics can be applied to game theory, because as I have told you, this Nash theorem, Nash equilibrium theorem, existence of the Nash equilibrium, it requires lot of topology, lot of function analysis. So it is actually based on the Kakutani's fixed point theorem. So Kakutani's fixed point theorem, when Kakutani's fixed point theorem was developed, nobody knew that it would be useful for game theory, existence of some equilibrium in game theory. But later on, it was found to be very helpful for the game theorists. That's the idea. Yeah.
Sir, one more question, which is not related to your presentation. So we know that you have met John Nash, so the legendary mathematician. So can you share the experience with us?
So actually, it was a good fortune on my part that I met him in Brazil, Sao Paulo. It was in 2015, probably. Yeah. 2014-15, something like that. So there was the big International Game Theory Congress, and I attended this, I participated in that. And I was very much fascinated seeing that person in front of me, and he was just moving here and there, talking to the people across the hall, and his wife was like eyeing on him, because he is not completely well till now, till his death itself. He was not completely well, and he was like kind of little bit, some kind of confused, or maybe I don't know how to put it. But then he just saw my name on my tag, Surojit Borkotoki. So this is, as usual, Borkotoki seems to be a Russian kind of word for most people outside India. In fact, within India also, I have found people who would say Borkotoki is a Russian kind of thing. So he asked me, where are you from? Then I told him that I'm from India, the northeastern part of India. Probably you must have, you know, sipped the Assam tea. He was like, kind of, he smiled and he said that, yes, I know Assam tea. Then he asked me about my area of research. Then I told so many things. Then he said, I invented game theory, but I don't know anything now. Because as you know, probably many of you know about John Nash, the beautiful mind. He developed schizophrenia after maybe around the age of 28, 29. Before that, he published everything. Whatever was supposed to be published, he published everything. So then he developed this schizophrenia, psychological very critical psychological disease. And then he started.
You are frozen, but your voice is coming a bit. Sir, can you hear?
Hello, sir.
Sir? I think his network has given away.
Probably I lost my connection, yes?
Yes, now it is here.
Okay.
I'm hearing you, sir.
Yeah. So then when he said again that I invented game theory, but I don't know game theory, then this Omen, Robert Omen, he said, that's why you are great. It was his comment on it. So this is it. It's a great experience on my part, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Anything?
So,
sir, there is actually a request from many people to make the presentation available. Is it possible to share the presentation with the audience?
Of course. I don't have any copyright.
Okay.
So I have already sent it to you, Manzil.
Yes.
So you can just share it to everyone.
Okay.
So I think what I suggest, you develop one archive, maybe in your Ganitsura. This is what we are doing also in our GameNet webinar series. We keep all these presentations in that archive. And everybody, whoever visits that kind of website, they will access it.
Okay, sir. Okay.
It's better than to share everyone
individually. Okay,
sir. So I think anything else?
So there are a lot of questions, but I think
I am happy to answer if I can. There is no problem. But look at the time.
I think the moderator has also frozen now, is it?
Yeah.
Parma, can you hear?
Yes, sir. So there is one more question. So I can take one more question. So how to play the game with a given matrix? One question. It's not clear, I guess.
Sorry. How to play the game with a given matrix? So there are two things, in fact, it's very difficult to, cover all these aspects in a particular talk of 1 hour. But let me clarify. There are two things. The first thing is there is a Nash equilibrium for sure. There is a Nash equilibrium for sure. Then if you know that Nash equilibrium, and if you agree to that Nash equilibrium, because it is not necessary that you agree to Nash equilibrium, because it depends on a particular set of players. If they don't agree to Nash equilibrium, they would go for some different equilibrium concept. Suppose I assume that the players would agree to Nash equilibrium. So they would find first whether there is a Nash equilibrium to the game or not in pure strategies. And if there is a Nash equilibrium, there is no one single Nash equilibrium, there is no point of playing the game. Everybody knows that this is my strategy because I'm a rational player. You are also intelligent and rational player. So everybody will take up this particular strategy and that will be over. The game is over. But suppose in the case of the, say, for example, game of sex, battle of sex, there are two net Nash equilibriums. One was like movie or cricket. So again, the same dilemma is there for both the players, whether to go to the movie or whether to go to the cricket. But they know that they would go together. They would be together. Then they can they can roll the dice or they can toss a coin according to the Nash equilibrium, because there is a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium out of it. So this mixed strategy Nash equilibrium will give you some probabilities, the equilibrium probabilities. And with the help of this equilibrium probabilities, they will try to find out which, what is the expected value for going to the movie or going to the cricket. Okay. So accordingly, they will try to find out exactly where to go. This is one way. Yeah.
So one last question.
Yeah.
So what is the scope nowadays after means doing research or studying game theory? Nowadays means what are the job scopes or other research scope on game theory?
Yeah, actually, as I have told you, there is a lot of scopes in computer science, in all branches of science and natural sciences, behavioral sciences, social sciences, everywhere you will find a lot of scopes of game theory. So it has, like, initially it was kind of a, you know, it was in the domain of mathematicians. Few mathematics people tried to, you know, apply some, you know, social situations by use of game theory, okay, mathematical models. But then everybody got the kind of, you know, flavor, everybody got the essence of this game theory, using game theory, and they found that everywhere it can be applied. So there is a lot of, you know, institutions, say, for example, if you look for research, then you can take mathematics in your undergraduates, and then you take the masters in the graduate postgraduate courses, and then you can you just look for somebody who is working on game theory, similar to our topics, which is kind of related to game theory. Then you definitely go for them and take this. And the scope is like in economics, there is a lot of scopes. In mathematics, there is a lot of scopes. Like research-wise, it has a lot of scopes. In decision-making, because the whole area is called decision-making. Game theory also falls under the broad area of decision-making. Decision-making under certain situations, decision-making under uncertain situations. Nowadays, every corporate sector, say for example, these software companies, big corporate houses, they recruit game theorists. Why? Because they want to play the games with their competitors. Okay? The computer scientists, the designers, game designers. Because the background is logic. If you know the logic, if you know the rational conditions, then you can find out the areas also, the avenues also.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So yeah. We surely had a fruitful session with you, sir.
Thank you very much.
So now I request Dr. Bhupen Chutia, sir, coordinator of IQAC Cell, Lakhimpur Girls College, to say a few words. Thank you, sir.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the fag end of this session today. IQAC of Lakhimpur Girls College is organizing a series of lectures from different departments. And this today was the first one organized by the Department of Mathematics in collaboration with Gonit Chara. On behalf of Lakhimpur Girls College, would like to express our gratitude to all the participants. Of course, our guest of honor, Professor Surajit Barkhotaki. I would like to thank him very much for this enlightening talk. I hope he will be responding to all the participants. We can see many questions remain. We failed to even accommodate so many questions. The participants will contact you I hope you will fulfill their, I am satisfied their queries. And then, of course, I would like to thank our Honorable Principal, Sir Surajit Bhuiya, sir, who has been the guiding principal behind this webinar series. And he has been a constant source of our inspiration. Thank you, Bhuiya, sir, for your kind guidance. Then, of course, the Department of Mathematics, head of the department is with us, Mr. Upenchanda Pujari, sir. He has been very much active in the whole business of organizing this webinar. And other members too are present. And special mention to our junior most assistant professor, Dr. Paramadotta, who has been, in fact, the sole force behind this particular webinar. And his energy, his enthusiasm has made it a success. Then, of course, the collaboration, we have been fortunate enough to have collaboration from Gonichara, and I would like to express our gratitude to Dr. Manjil Pratim Shaikia, who is the editor of Gonichara, Ahom. Thank you very much, Manjil. And of course, all the participants, we in fact had 380 registered participants registered actually, but in actuality, around 220 are participating today. I would like to thank all of them for their enthusiastic participation, for their queries. I would like to assure them that we are going to provide their certificates of participation within a few days. We'll send them the link for downloading the certificates. Then, of course, here is our Mr. Hiranand Saikia, PhD scholar from ISI Kolkata, who has been helping us in technical side. And one more person is working behind the scene. Is our Bhaskarjit Bora. He is the computer faculty of this department, of this college. And he is actually looking after the certificate section. I'd like to express our gratitude to both of them. And then all the other members of the Lakhimpur Girls College family, they are extending their cooperation. I would like to thank you all once again. Have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.